Okay, well, it's a pleasure to be here. This is, I think, my fourth or fifth time to Melbourne. I always love coming down here, and it's a pleasure to be able to do talks like this. As Pedro said, before I went to the Federal Reserve, I was an academic for about 30 years until I moved into the policy world. And the big advantage of moving into that world was I have to go out and give a lot of public presentations to the general public, which I never did as an academic. I talked to students and other eggheads like myself. So this is actually part of my job that I've really come to enjoy, is talking about policy to the just the general public. So I'm going to talk about the near-term outlook for the U.S. economy. And I have to talk like an academic. I can't read a speech, so I'm going to be moving around just like I was lecturing. And I always have to put up a disclaimer. This is standard rules for Federal Reserve employees, that the views I have today are my own and do not reflect the position of the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis, the Federal Reserve System, or the FOMC, the Federal Open Market Committee, even if I think they should take on those positions. They ignore me. All right, so what's the big picture for the U.S. economy right now? Well, it's pretty much the same story we've seen for the last year, two, 3 years, which is very modest growth in national income and output, fairly healthy labor market conditions, and inflation is finally starting to show some signs of life. One of the things I'll touch on a bit is investment by businesses has been a big concern for the last 8 or 9 years. And we're waiting to see if this ever happens again, and it's hampering productivity. And we have a new political administration, which has sparked a fair amount of optimism among financial markets, businesses, and consumers. And however, there's a huge amount of uncertainty facing particularly the Federal Reserve in terms of what we're going to do in terms of normalizing monetary policy, since we've done some very extraordinary things over the last 9 years in response to the financial crisis that we have yet to unwind. And I'll talk about how that's going to happen going forward. So here's kind of three themes I'm going to touch on during this talk. The first is a data divergence. The second is Trumphoria, or for other people, what the hell just happened, okay? And then talk about normalization, and particularly the Fed's balance sheet, which Congress has suddenly taken a great interest in a number of ways that are creating some issues for us as monetary policymakers. So what's this data divergence? Well, here's kind of the data. As we head into our eighth year of expansion, which is sort of long by business cycle frequencies normally, real GDP grew by 1.9% in 2016. But for the previous 150 years of U.S. history, the average growth rate of the economy was around 3 to 3.2%. But since the recession, we've been growing at 2%, 2.1%. So we're kind of 1.9, 2.1 is close enough for a macroeconomist. So that's kind of the idea. We're kind of growing at this pace. It's nothing bad, no recessions, but not what we saw for the previous 150 years. Now, consumer spending has been a huge strength in the economy during the recovery, as has construction activity in various sectors. Now, here's the disconnect. What I was kind of giving you is some hard data on the GDP. I'm going to talk about some other hard data in terms of the labor market. And that's the hard data. But the soft data is all the consumer and business confidence. And these things are soaring by every measure you can imagine. Corporate profit forecasts are up based on this consumer and business confidence. But when you look at GDP and investment, nobody's changing their tune. You talk to the same people who are all optimistic about the economy, and you say, what's going to happen to GDP and investment? And they give you the same numbers we've seen for the last couple of years. So this is what we mean. There seems to be a disconnect. Capital spending doesn't appear to be soaring. You talk to these same firms, they're not saying, oh, I'm going to suddenly invest like crazy in the U.S. So a lot of the contacts that we have say, look, we're just not certain what the hell is going to happen with the current administration. There's a lot of talk, but we haven't seen a lot of action in a way that we think will improve the economy. So this is it. It's just, I'm going to show you some charts. I'm an economist. I have no, can't help it. It's like an addiction. So these are just consumer and small business confidence. And you can see since the election, there's just been this spike up. Everybody's suddenly much more confident in the U.S. economy. They seem to be much happier. All of our business contacts that I talk to, CEOs of corporations, they're like, I can't really put my finger on it, but I'm telling you, everybody just seems to be so giddy right now. And the same thing, if you look at the chief financial officers of major U.S. corporations, which the Duke survey does, look at this spike. I mean, there's just this massive spike in optimism after the election among CFOs of major U.S. corporations. Now, one of the things, this is just kind of breaking down some major impacts on GDP. And all I'm going to try to point out is over the last couple of years, the big contributing factor to GDP growth are the blue columns, which is consumer spending. We've seen very good, robust consumer spending in the U.S. But investment has been negative for a large part until just the last quarter. And net exports have also been a pretty significant drag on GDP. So the two things that have kind of been hurting the U.S. economy, weak investment and net exports. Now, this is one that's kind of more troubling. So all this graph is showing is the total amount of capital, which I always tell everybody, just think about tools, machinery, and buildings to make stuff or sell stuff. This is the inputs per hour of work. So it's kind of take any hour of work by a U.S. employee, how much capital is being given or tools to these workers. This is the growth rate. Boy, that's a pretty noticeable zero. Okay, so there's very little new investment capital technology going to workers, and that's on taking into account the fact that total hours worked in the U.S. has dropped dramatically because fewer people are actually working. Even though unemployment's relatively low, I'll show you in a second, there's a dramatic drop off in the number of adults working in the U.S. So this is the concern. The average is about 2.5%, and we've been basically flat since 2008 or 9. So this is where people are kind of saying, what's going on? Larry Summers has talked about secular stagnation. We're in this kind of bad world where nobody wants to invest because everything's terrible. This is just one more slide on investment. If you break it into equipment versus structures, you see the same basic pattern. Since about the recession, it's just been a collapse below the average and it's never recovered. Usually after a recession, these things rebound, come up above average, and then settle back down. But it just didn't happen after the last recession. Now, this is something that's very important. When I show you these 1.9, 2.1% GDP growth rates, standard reasons you have economic growth, you have more employment, which either comes through population growth or more hours, or more bodies coming in off the sideline, or those workers are just much more productive. So one of the critical numbers in economics is productivity per worker. That drives a lot of how your income is going to grow and your standard of living. And what I'm just trying to stress here is there seems to be a pattern in the U.S. of what in St. Louis we've taken to call productivity regimes, for lack of a better word. If you look up to 73, productivity grew at about 2.8%, meaning each worker's average productivity went up 2.8%. Then for a long period during the 70s up to the mid-90s, it was half of that. There was a massive productivity slowdown in the U.S. that had everybody wondering what was going on for about 20 years. And then we had a big surge in productivity again from the mid-90s to the mid-2000s, where it went back up to its almost longer-term average. And then it's tanked again since about 2006. We're talking about a decade. So these are not quarter-to-quarter, maybe annual. These are decade movements. Okay, so these are serious drops that last a long time. It goes up for a long time or it comes down for a long time. And I'll come back to that later. So where is all this optimism coming from? Because I'm not showing you anything in the data that should make you really happy per se. So basically this is kind of the idea is that a lot of the proposals that the new administration has put out in terms of fiscal policy, tax policy, that if they're implemented effectively, this is going to have a huge impact for the benefit on the U.S. economy. So if there is a huge surge in federal spending for military infrastructure, this would be the standard kind of fiscal stimulus that drives demand for goods and services and boosts growth, at least temporarily. Reduced regulation has been something that's already been underway. There's a widespread belief that the previous administration strangled the U.S. economy with overregulation. I get that all the time from my business contacts in the U.S., that this was killing investment in the U.S. One of the CEOs on our board of directors runs a large energy gas trading company, and she made the comment that 20 years ago, to build a 70-mile pipeline, which only takes 3 months of construction. It only took 6 months to get regulatory approval to build it. The last one they went to do took 3 years. They didn't bother doing it. It just wasn't worth waiting 3 years to do this. They just figured it was some other way to do it. So those are the kind of anecdotes we hear all the time from private sector people that about regulation. And then a big one is there's a belief, and it probably is gonna, I'm gonna tell you, I'm almost certain it's gonna happen. There's gonna be lower corporate profit taxes. That's gonna lead to higher after-tax dividends. And what the markets are doing is they're pricing in those dividends right now before they actually are realized. This is what the financial markets do. If they're functioning properly, they price it in ahead of time. So that's kind of where all the euphoria, you look at the financial markets, this is what is driving a lot of this. All right, now let me just talk about the US labor market. So despite the anemic labor productivity, we've had very healthy job gains. In 2016, we averaged 187,000 new jobs a month. And in January, we just got the data last week, 227,000 jobs. Now, to give you a benchmark, if your economy was employing people at the rate of population growth, which would mean your employment rate would be constant, that number would be, we need to add about 100,000 jobs a month. So just to handle new entrants into the labor force, we only need to add about 100,000 jobs a month. So these are huge gains in employment. Now, kind of the puzzle I've always told my business contacts, if productivity is so bad, why are you hiring these people? You know, I don't want to say they're so unproductive you need to hire two to do the work of one, but that seems to be the puzzle. If productivity is so low, why is employment growth so strong? And the strongest job growth has been in professional business services and construction. Like I said, the unemployment rate is 4.8% in the U.S. We think of full employment at the Federal Reserve and the FOMC, which is the interest rate decision body in the Federal Reserve, as around 5%. So we're at what we call full employment when unemployment's around 4.8%. So, but there's still some damage that's occurred that hasn't been fixed, and I'll show you that here in a slide or two. So there's various measures of the unemployment rate, and despite President Trump claiming the unemployment rate is fake data, it's the data, and we've used it for 70 years, so you can see patterns in it, even if you think it's biased. But here's two measures of the unemployment rate. This is U3, which is the one we look at the Fed most of the time, the standard unemployment rate. It's down about 4.8. And the median since about 1948 is about 5.6%. So we're below kind of normal unemployment rates, which is telling you the labor market's doing pretty good, like I showed you with that job creation. Now the red line is U6. This is the broadest measure of unemployment. This includes people who aren't looking for a job now but have looked in the last year. That's the difference. The blue line is, are you looking right now, this month? So you said, nah, I quit looking, things were so bad. Well, by this blue line, you're not in the labor force then. But the red line is, have you looked in the last year? Are you discouraged? You just quit looking for a job because things were so bad? Are you working part-time when you really want to work full-time? These are all measures of kind of underemployment. So you see that whatever the case is, both of them are back. Even the red line, which is the broadest thing, it's back to almost the lows in the last expansion. So it was bad, but it's gotten much better. So we're seeing a lot of unemployment is basically back to where it was in good times and the best it's ever been. Now, one of the things that's been a concern for us in some sense, but it's not really that big of a shock, is real wage growth. So the black line is the growth in nominal wages. The blue line is the inflation rate. So the gap is kind of telling you what's happened to your real after inflation wage income. And you can see that during the pretty much from 09 all the way to about 13 or 14, they're about even, meaning all of your wage gains in the U.S. were just compensating for inflation, which, if your productivity growth sucks, isn't a big surprise. If you're not being more productive, the only thing you're getting paid for is compensating for inflation. So that's not a surprise to many of us. But what we've seen is we've finally been seeing some real wage growth traction as this gap, since about 2014, has gotten wider, partly because nominal wages have been growing faster and inflation has tanked. So in real terms, what you're getting is buying you more goods and services than it did in the last. So this is a positive sign for us at the Fed for real wage growth. Now, these are the two things that are getting a lot of attention. One is the labor force participation rate, which is what fraction of the adult population is actually working or looking for work. Okay, so it'd be employed and unemployed. And the big concern is this thing, since about 2000, has been going down. And it had a drop off after the Great Recession. Now, for the U.S., the main explanation for this is purely demographics. It's an aging workforce as the baby boomers age and start leaving the workforce. This number of where we are here was predicted back here, almost exactly. They knew just from, I mean, demographics move very slowly, right? People age slowly, populations grow slowly. It's easy to kind of predict what's going to happen. So this isn't so much the surprise, but the critical thing is there are fewer and fewer adults in the U.S. who are choosing to be in the labor force. Some of it's just they're getting old and retiring. That's a large part of it. Now, the bigger problem is the red line, which is the employment population. So this is take all the employed people as a fraction of the total population. That's what employment, EPOP, stands for. And what you see is when the recession hit is a really serious drop in this ratio, and it really hasn't come back. This isn't demographics. This is some business cycle effect that hit that caused a permanent change in the amount of people that are choosing to work. So that's really the thing where the labor market hasn't totally recovered. This kind of bouncing around at around 62 to 63%, that's where it was for 25, 30 years. Dropping all the way down to below 60 and staying there for a long time and not coming back is what's the concern. Okay? All right. So the other thing, so at the Fed, we have a mandate from Congress to do basically three things. Maximize employment, which we take to mean having unemployment near about 5%. Keep inflation low and stable, which our target is 2%. And then financial stability, try not to have another financial crisis. Okay, we'll try, I'll do all three of those things. So one of the things to tell people, we also look around the world and interest rates are tremendously low around the world. Now, interest rates are going to tend to be low when there's low productivity growth. This is the real return from holding something over time. And when inflation is very low. Both of those things are going to cause interest rates to be low, no matter what a central bank does. So one of the things that I go around the world telling people is the low interest rates aren't necessarily caused by the central banks in the world. They're caused because inflation is extremely low and productivity growth is very low. Okay, we could do anything we wanted. It's not going to change that. Now, what we've seen is rising oil prices have started to put some upward pressure in inflation for the last 6 months or so. And we've also got market-based measures of inflation expectation. Where do you think inflation is going in the future? And that has also picked up. So I'll kind of walk through a couple of this. So this is oil prices. 2007-08, we had a massive run-up where oil went to almost $150 a barrel. Recession hits, it crashes down to below 50, rebounds, and then in 2014 crashes and has, for the most part, stayed down. So this is coinciding with that big drop-off in inflation in 2014. Just oil prices tanked. This had a big ripple effect through all forms of production, manufacturing, consumer goods. And it's just kind of stayed down. Now, there's been a lot of discussion in the last few months by OPEC members saying we want to rein in production to try to push oil prices back up. And if that happens, is that going to create problems? My take on this is that the U.S. fracking industry, shale oil industry, anything that the Saudis or the Iranians do to cut back production and push up oil prices, these guys are going to step right in and fill the void. Okay, so I don't see whatever OPEC is doing is going to have a whole lot of impact on oil prices just because the U.S. oil shale fracking industry is going to step in and produce any gap that comes about from OPEC. So I don't foresee oil prices taking off because of the OPEC compromise. And the other thing with cartels, and whenever they do this stuff, they all cheat. They always cheat. They get the Saudis to cut back, and then everybody else goes, that's great. They pushed up oil prices. Let's sell some more. Okay? This is why these things always break down. The Saudis always, every so often, have to be the enforcer. The problem is now the U.S. fracking industry is not part of OPEC, and they don't really care. Okay? They're not agreeing to anything. So this is about inflation. So as I said, our 2% target is what we aim inflation to be. The headline, the PCE is a particular price index that we look at as the Fed. And you can see that ever since about 2012, we have come nowhere close to hitting 2% inflation. Which, I'll tell you, all my adult life as an economist growing up, the problem was not how can central banks create inflation. The question is, how do you stop them from creating inflation? To now, we can't get inflation to get to 2%. I don't know where we lost our superpower, but somehow we did. Because you can see, we want 2%, we can't get close to it. We're getting there, and we think we're going to. And then the blue line is a measure of inflation expectations measured from treasury bills, treasury securities. There are two types of securities. There's a non-indexed, and there's an indexed treasury security. The only thing difference is one compensates you for inflation, and the other doesn't. Same issuer, same maturity, same default risk, same everything, except one gives you inflation and protection and one does not. So from these two, you should be indifferent whether you want one that's protected or not if they're priced efficiently. So based on that idea, we can back out what expected inflation is by the prices you're willing to pay for it. And you can see that now that number's, you know, was around 2%, 2.3% for a long time, dropped below 2, and now has kind of come back up. So one of the things we often say at the Fed in our FOMC statements is, are inflation expectations well anchored? Because if they're well anchored, then small movements in the actual inflation rate probably aren't going to do a whole lot of damage. This period had us a little worried, I'll be honest. People were a little concerned that maybe they weren't so well anchored. But we now have some hope that we're starting to see inflation coming back, that we should hit our target, and when we look farther out, we don't see long-run inflation expectations shooting off above 2%. Now, this is our own St. Louis Fed model that we use for predicting what type of inflation world are we in. So the black line is just estimates of our probability that inflation is going to be 0 to 1.5%. We're putting that at about 50-50. Right now. So still not at 2, but not, you know, this number was a lot higher, almost 80% just, you know, about a year or so ago. From 1.5 to 2.5 is the red line. We put that at about 30%. That would mean you're kind of in the ballpark of where you should be. And anything over 2.5 would be considered getting on the high inflation side. We put that at almost very, very low probability event. So we don't see inflation as being a threat going forward based on our statistical models. Now, the Federal Open Market Committee, which is the group that sets interest rates in the U.S., and some say set it for the world in many cases, every quarter they're asked to give some projections by all the members of this committee what they think is going to happen to GDP, inflation, and unemployment in the coming years. And so the central tendency is the group in the middle, right? Throw out the high, throw out the low, take the middle, where do you think they're going to be? And this is one thing I want to stress for something later in the talk. Notice that they don't see anything changing. In other words, the FOMC, the group that's setting interest rates in the Federal Reserve, don't see GDP growth accelerating, they don't see unemployment rate going up or down, and they don't see inflation doing anything but hitting 2%. So it looks like you're just in neutral. The economy's right where it's supposed to be. Full employment, inflation's at 2. Check the boxes, we did our job, right? Take the cape off and go take the evening off. So that's kind of the idea. So when I come back to monetary policy, keep these things in mind. This is our own body. This is our own decision makers. This is their outlook. All right, Trumporia. I knew I was going to get asked questions, so feel free later. I'll see what I can say and what I can't say. As we said, U.S. equity prices have surged to record levels since the election of Trump. the things they've, here's the thing what we know about the Trump administration. They say a lot of things. We're not sure exactly what they're going to do. They're really short on details. So we're going to do everything, and we're going to do it big. We're going to do huge. But how you're going to do it, we'll worry about that later. So these, when I talk about some of this, it's just we're not sure exactly what they're going to do, but we kind of have some rough economic ideas what these things tend to do if you carried them out. So these are the four big things that seem to have come out of the Trump administration on economic policy. Significant tax cuts and tax reform, increased federal spending on defense and infrastructure, a lot of rollback of deregulation across the board, across all industries, and then clearly issues about trade reform, renegotiating trade treaties, various things like that. Pretty much everybody's in agreement that some form of these things are all going to happen. It's not really that they will or they won't. It's what form are they going to take and how much. That's what we're trying to understand right now. So just look at the stock prices. You win the election, stock market goes up roughly 7-8%. Why? Again, this is this optimism. Okay, but I mean, it's clearly there. This is fantastic. This is raising the wealth of the top 25% of the U.S. income distribution, because that's who holds all the stocks. So this is great, you know, if you're in the top 25% of the income distribution. If you're below 75, this is just like watching some chart go up and down. It doesn't mean anything to you. Now, we don't, again, we don't know what President Trump is going to actually propose for tax policies. So the best guess we have is we seem to believe that he's sympathetic to the House of Representatives' tax plans, which have been put forward in public already. So this is roughly, the black is what the current law is, and the red is what the House plan would do. And it's pretty clear the House plan would cut the tax rate on wage income, significantly cut the tax rate on capital gains, taxable interest, dividends, and then a huge one on corporate profit taxes. Okay, notice that wage income tax cuts are the smallest. Okay, again, this is clearly a one-sided tax cut plan, which, well, there it is. All right, now you go to the blue chip, which is the Wall Street forecasters. Their forecast for profit growth has jumped dramatically from 3 to 5% based on all these things that they think are going to happen, mainly the tax reform, which can happen very quickly, by the way. Of all those things that's going to happen quick, tax reform can be put in place by August. Everything else is going to take a while. Okay. Now, the other thing that's been a bit of a surprise is the change in the 10-year U.S. Treasury, which is one of the big assets traded around the world by everybody. It's a very deep, very large, very liquid pool. And from the election, I mean, we've seen this thing jump almost 80 basis points, 0.75 percentage point. Nothing's changed other than this outlook, and interest rates have jumped. So when I've talked to my contacts on Wall Street and other chief economists at the investment banks and the big banks, they say, what do you think is going on? How do you explain this? Their answer is they think Trump's going to generate a lot of inflation from all the fiscal stimulus, although I showed you that doesn't seem to be showing up in prices anywhere. And they think it's going to cause all this economic growth, which I told you requires productivity growth. I don't know how any of this is going to improve worker productivity in the U.S. That's the, as of yet, tax cuts aren't going to necessarily change productivity. You may work more hours, but it doesn't mean you're going to be any better at it. So this is a bit of a puzzle that we've seen this jump in yields just since the election when nothing has happened yet. All right, so one of the big things that everybody talks about with President Trump is infrastructure. He's going to make America great again. Okay, I always thought it was great. I don't know what happened. But so when you think about infrastructure spending, you're typically thinking about changes in the public capital stock. So you're talking about roads, highways, airports, bridges, ports of entry, all these things. Also schools and things like that should be in there. Now, if you're going to go through and replace the entire electrical grid in the U.S., there's going to be an immediate impact from just a pure demand side. You need materials and labor to build it. This will be the immediate impact of any kind of stimulus. But we think the benefit of this in the medium and the long run is all going to come through on productivity. If you have a better public capital stock, better electrical grids, better airports, better highways, better rail systems, these things are going to improve private sector productivity as well. This is why I've never seen a firm ever say, I'm going to build a plant in the middle of a field 50 miles from a highway or a train line. What a shock. No, they want that public capital near them. Okay, and so their investment decisions hinge on these public capital. And then one of the things I try to stress is that a lot of public investment is not just about productivity. It's about improving the quality of life for a lot of people. You want to reduce inequities. That's a large part of education policy. It's not about maximizing productivity or returns. It's about equity and also just functioning of the government itself. Now, this is one thing where, again, the infrastructure thing has a lot of support in the U.S., both on the Democratic and the Republican side. Even Paul Krugman, who despises Trump as the second coming of Satan, likes infrastructure spending. Okay? And there's general agreement that while the quantity of public capital in the U.S. may be fine, the level or the percentage of total capital, the quality of it has been deteriorating. In large part, I don't have slides, but large part is the U.S. capital, public capital stock is aging rapidly, and it's just being maintained and repaired. We're not kind of replacing it at the rate we should with new structures and equipment. So that's what this World Economic Forum is kind of showing, the overall assessment of the U.S. Public capital stock, and it's been declining for 10 years. So that's why I said there's a lot of support. So things like this are going to get a fairly robust political support for them. Now, the kind of the issue is this going to do a lot for the U.S. economy in terms of productivity, GDP growth, things like that? Well, first of all, there's this problem with crowding out. If you're going to finance all this spending by deficit spending, borrowing, then what's going to happen is you're going to tend to put upward pressure on those treasury. Remember I showed you the spike in the treasury rates. That's exactly what they're kind of building in. The Congressional Budget Office said for each dollar that the federal deficit increases, domestic private investment falls by 33 cents. This is what we mean by crowding out. You spend a dollar on public capital, you drive down private capital by 33 cents because of the higher interest cost. It's more expensive and more costly for private firms to invest, so they cut back on the margin. Lags. So all this infrastructure spending may make America great again, but it may take 20 years. This is the thing with these kind of things. The best example of this was when the U.S. was the electrification of U.S. industrial production in the 1910s and 20s. Electricity showed up in 1900 to 1910. It didn't show up really in factories and industrialization on a large scale for 20 years in the 1920s. This is why the 20s were a great decade. Massive productivity because of electrification. But that's the point. There was electricity for 20 years, but it didn't show up in the data till the 1920s. The other example is computers. Laptop computers exploded in the early 80s. They were ubiquitous across every firm, school, everything by the early 90s. Robert Sowell had this famous quote, which was, I see computers everywhere except in the productivity data. They don't seem to be doing anything to productivity. And then what happens around 94, 95? I showed you, productivity doubles for the next decade. So all of these things take a while to integrate themselves through the U.S. production chain to enhance productivity and show up in the data. So all this infrastructure, it may well do it, whatever they're going to do. It just may take a long time. And then the last thing is we're never able as economists to really isolate the impact of this stuff on GDP growth. There's a million things going on all at the same time. And saying this was the one thing that caused X is one of the hardest problems in economics and econometrics to figure out. Okay, well, the dollar. So let me make a comment. In the U.S., the Federal Reserve is kind of pseudo-prohibited from talking about the U.S. dollar as policy. That's the U.S. Treasury, and it's the Treasury's preserve, and not even the president comments until this one. And he's very happy to talk about what he thinks the dollar should or shouldn't be. So a lot of these trade and tax proposals are clearly going to influence the value of the dollar. Okay, if corporate profits are going to be brought back to the U.S., that's going to have to come back in the form of dollars. That's going to drive up the demand for dollars relative to all other currencies. If investment and productivity growth look great going forward in the U.S., money's going to, capital flows are going to come into the U.S., pushing up the U.S. dollar. Various trade things that are going to happen are going to lead to potentially appreciation of the dollar. Now, what is being bandied about by the administration and the House of Representatives at the moment is this border tax adjustment, which is the way to, I kind of think of it as a profit, corporate profit tax, but in a slightly different way. In a corporate profit tax, you take your revenues and you subtract off your cost and you pay tax on the difference. What the border tax says is, guess what? If we're going to take your cost and break it into imports and domestic cost, and if they're costs from imports, you don't get to deduct that. So you're effectively going to tax imports of intermediate goods. And on your revenues, the sale, we're going to break it between domestic and foreign. And if you sell it abroad, you don't have to count that in your revenues. So again, you're subsidizing exports and taxing imports in measuring corporate profits. So this is an indirect way of taxing imports and subsidizing exports without actually doing it. I mean, with an explicit tariff or subsidy. So anyway, this is kind of what this is doing. The Trump administration, the Republicans are claiming that actually a lot of countries around the world do this to the U.S., and we're just leveling the playing field by doing it as well. So that's why there is not as much animosity about this among places in the U.S. Now, the other thing is there's some price effects, again, dollar effects on this that people will talk about, and they'll say, you know, if you do this, what it's going to do is it's going to increase the demand for dollars. The dollar's going to appreciate relative to the Mexican peso. So, yes, even though the imports are going to be taxed, you're now going to buy them at a lower exchange rate. And, yes, your exports are subsidized, but you're going to sell them at a much more higher exchange rate. So, in some sense, this will all be a wash. That seems to be a common refrain on this border adjustment. It's just not going to matter at the end of the day. The problem is, I'm going to tell you right now, the U.S. exchange rate is not driven by trade flows between Mexico and the U.S. They're driven by capital flows daily in the trillions of dollars, not $50 billion, $50 million of exports of whatever cocaine comes across the border. So that's what, I wouldn't put any stock in these arguments that the exchange rate is going to adjust to make this all neutral. It's just not going to happen. All right, so when you look at the trade-weighted value of the dollar, we had a long decline in the king dollar from about 2002 to 2012. But since the collapse in oil, we've seen a pretty marked appreciation of the dollar, which President Trump seems to like a lot, which I always find strange, given his mercantilist tendencies, to want to export and not import. That's the worst thing that can happen is to have a strong. It makes your exports expensive and the imports cheap. So I don't understand. This is, well, I won't comment. It just doesn't seem to match what he seems to want to do. And you can see, since the election, the dollar has appreciated against our biggest trading partners, which hurts your exports and makes the imports look cheaper. Okay, so it's just kind of going against all of this stuff. But, you know, why would you bother bringing the jobs back when now they're even cheaper to produce abroad? All right, so now I'll talk in the last few minutes here. I'm starting to ramble. So I'll talk about what I do for a living. Everything up to now has just been chattering and making comments I probably shouldn't. I hope you're not tweeting all this stuff. So I'm going to talk about monetary policy. So one of the things that we are staring at is we've had a huge crisis, a huge recession. We've spent about 8 years now trying to repair the damage. Part of it we think we're helping do. But if you tried to measure how far away from you in some simple mathematical way are you from achieving your goals? So if I was meeting my goals exactly, I should be at zero. And what you can see is we're pretty close. Okay, I showed you inflation is just a little bit below 2%. Unemployment's a little bit below 2%, or it's 4-5%. So we've pretty much hit everything we're supposed to do. Now, this is where I'm going to break from, I'll talk about policy from the St. Louis perspective. We've been sitting here staring at this data saying, economy looks pretty normal. Labor markets for the most part have healed. Inflation is pretty close to 2%, close enough for a macro guy like me. So the economy looks fine. But we still have interest rates at historic lows. Okay, the policy rate's between 50 and 75 basis points. Long run, it's been 3.5% to 4. So our interest rates are still historically very, very low. We have a balance sheet that we blew up during the quantitative easing and all this. And that's still putting a lot of downward pressure on longer term rates. So we're doing all of this, but the economy seems to be back to normal. So you have to start scratching your head, what's really going on? And this is this kind of view we have, this regime is like, there's something going on with interest rates that's not normal. I mean, the economy's back to normal, but interest rates are nowhere near normal. Okay? And so that has led us to take the following view. If the economy looks like it's normal, and I showed you the projections early, this was a setup, that all the central members of the FOMC think GDP growth is going to be where it's at, fine, unemployment's right where it's supposed to be, inflation's right where it's supposed to be for the next 3 years, why are you raising interest rates? Which is what the middle of the SEP, the middle of the FOMC committee is saying, we think by about a little over 2 years from now, almost 3 years, the interest policy rate should be at 3%. It's at, like I said, 50 to 75 basis points right now. You're talking about raising the interest policy interest rate 250 basis points when you don't see any reason for it in the economy. So, St. Louis has said, look, we must be doing pretty well where we're at right now. Economy's doing fine. Inflation's fine. Nothing bad seems to be on anybody's horizon. So why are we going to try to drive interest rates up to 350 basis points, 3.5%? Our mandate from Congress is not to raise interest rates. That's not our mandate. Maximum employment, price stability, inflation stability, or financial stability. So somebody asked me this morning, well, maybe they see financial instability. That's why you got to raise rates. Well, every time I ask people who do this, what's the financial instability? Nobody sees it. Okay? It's not like it's something out there that everybody's going, oh my God, watch this explosion. The world's going to go into another crisis. We got to raise rates by 350 basis points. It's just not there. So the kind of our view of this is that for some reason, which I'm going to say is a scarcity of safe assets in the world, which is typically developed country government debt, particularly the U.S., Japan, and Germany, those seem to be the three safest forms of government debt, there isn't enough supply of it for the demand for it in the world. For some reason, the world wants to hold a lot of very safe, liquid government debt, and they're willing to pay a very high price and accept a very low return for it. Okay? I don't know why that is. You go out and buy a 10-year treasury bill right now, it's 2.3, inflation's 2, you're taking a zero real return. You go to a 1-year treasury, you're taking a minus 1.5%. Up front, you're saying, fine, I'm going to lose 1.5% this year. That's a great investment strategy. But people are doing it. Okay, so for some reason, the world wants these safe liquid assets. Okay, they don't want to go hold risky productive capital. I showed you the investment stuff is really low. They don't want to hold that stuff. Even though the return on that stuff, by all the research of my staff, hasn't changed in 30 or 40 years. They still just want this safe liquid stuff. Well, shut up, I'm running out of time. I got a whole talk just on that one item. Oh, so what are we doing? Okay, so this is what I just said. The FOMC has forecast 3 hikes this year, so that by the end of this year, the policy rate should be somewhere in the neighborhood of 150 basis points for the U.S., or 1.5%. We showed you all these confidence numbers, but we don't pay any attention because all of that shows up in asset prices. So once we see the asset price, that's all we need. The consumer sentiment isn't telling you any more, really, than what you're seeing in asset prices. Now, the probability that we're going to raise rates in the next meeting in March, the markets are pricing that at basically a 1 in 4 chance. They just don't see us doing anything in March to raise rates. We'll see. The FOMC has said we're going to raise it 3 times. The markets are saying 1 to 2. Over the last 4 years, who's won the bet every year? The markets. We've said 3 hikes this year, 2 to 4 hikes this year, every year for 4 years. We've done 2 in 2 years. So our credibility is a little weak on this, and the markets know it. So what about the balance sheet? So I'll end on this. This is actually the biggest problem confronting us. Before the financial crisis, we ran a balance sheet of about $800 to $900 billion. Once I came to the Fed, I had to learn to start speaking in trillions. I don't really understand what a trillion is except a bunch of zeros, but we did quantitative easing, a bunch of things to try to suppress long-term rates, stimulate, get the economy off its butt and moving again, and we now have a balance sheet of about $4.5 trillion, which is enormous by historical standards in the U.S. Now, even though we stopped buying in 2014, we have purposely kept our balance sheet at that size. Anything that gets paid off, we roll it over. We call it reinvestment. So our balance sheet has stayed the same. And we have said that we will keep the balance sheet large until we're well into this tightening cycle. So this is what our balance sheet looks like. We have about $2.3 trillion in U.S. Treasuries. We have about another $2 trillion in what we call agency mortgage-backed securities. So the Federal Reserve is pretty much the largest funder of the housing market in the United States and has been since the financial crisis. So that's what we're doing. We are the most profitable corporation in the world. We make $90 billion in profit every year. And we hand that over to the U.S. Treasury. Here you go. Thank us, quit spitting on us and yelling at us. Just take the profits and move on. So that's a lot of revenue, but nevertheless, people want to normalize the balance sheet. They want us to get back. There's this longing to just get back to 2006. If we could just get back to before the crisis, where monetary policy did this and did, that's gone, folks. It's just not going to happen. So that's what our balance sheet looks like. We said we are not willing to start shrinking it until we're well underway normalizing rates. By normalizing, I mean raising rates. So based on surveys of primary dealers in Wall Street, their projection is they think we will finally stop reinvestment and let our balance sheet start to shrink by the middle of 2018. Now, this is one of the things that we find a little bothersome in St. Louis, and we've actually made this point to the committee. You're talking about raising rates at the short end of the term structure, 1 year or less, but you're keeping this large balance sheet to try to suppress long rates. So you're pushing short rates up and trying to hold long rates down. And what you're trying to do is kind of flatten or invert the yield curve. And the question is, why are you doing this? This is silly. If you're going to raise the short end, you should let the long end rise too. So sell off and start getting rid of the balance sheet while you're raising rates. And again, we're not going to return to $800 billion. It's just not going to happen. We might go down to $2 trillion, but we're going nowhere near $800 billion. The last thing I'll skip. Now, risk to our economic outlook. Well, there's always, as a policymaker, you're worried about the next recession. But recessions never die of old age. It's not you say, ah, it's coming. It's going to be there. You can't predict these things. But they're not very predictable. That's the key thing. What are other unexpected events? One of the things people have talked about is this surge in energy prices after OPEC. I've tried to kind of argue that U.S. fracking is going to probably prevent that from happening. We could have a collapse in asset prices. If all these policies of the Trump administration, for some reason, don't go through, don't generate growth, don't generate higher corporate profits, bang, those asset prices are going to collapse. And this always, trust me, this spooks central banks around the world when you have big asset declines. Okay. And geopolitical risk, given the president's tendency to do foreign policy on Twitter, you pick the country. That's the risk you face. I think it's probably any one of them. Like I said, the high price earnings ratios are all about growth and tax regulatory. If that doesn't happen, you could see this. Now, if growth and inflation surprise to the upside, growth is higher, inflation's higher, unemployment falls more, then we know as the central bank how to counter that. That would justify all those higher rate hikes. So we're not worried about the upside risk here because we know how to deal with that. It's more on the downside risk that we're near the zero lower bound or zero interest rates. Our balance sheet is already huge. If we were to get hit by another bad shock or recession, the Fed might be with its back up against the wall and what it could do to help the economy. So that's the key takeaways. We have low anemic growth, but we're basically fully employed. We just have very low productivity. Okay, and again, all the policies I've heard are never talked about how they're going to raise the productivity of the average American worker. I never hear that ever being mentioned. So it's going to cause growth. Well, it's not going to do it through higher productivity from what I can see. Confidence is booming, but hard data is lagging behind all this confidence and optimism. So this is a question of, are markets rational with great foresight, or are they consumed by animal spirits that are going to get disappointed at some point? Okay. Some of the fiscal and regulatory things could boost growth if they're properly designed and implemented. That's what we don't know. Those are the details we haven't gotten. So right now, this is all a fog. We're in the fog of policy war. And as we start to normalize, our balance sheet is going to be a key focal point. I say this because Congress has now finally lasered in on our balance sheet. Even though we turn over $90 billion in profits, they don't like our balance sheet. And they really don't like that we are the primary financer of the housing market through all those mortgage-backed securities. So if we were to try to sell off all these mortgage-backed securities, you're going to see mortgage rates take off, and that would do a lot of potential damage to any administration, but Congress wants us to somehow start getting rid of this stuff. There's a few other things I'll just leave off, and I'll stop there.